views and opinions expressed do not necessarily reflect those of Access for Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting groups. If you'd like to produce a show, call us at 260-421-1250.
Hello, this is Patty Hunter. Welcome to my show, Patty's Page. Today I have two very special people with me. To my right here is John Dickmeyer, my co-host. Sir, hi. And to his right is Dr. John Crawford. Hello, sir.
Thank you for having me today.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, you, sir, are Fort Wayne City Council at large.
Correct.
When did you get elected?
Initially in 1995.
1995? Mm-hmm. That's a long time, eh?
It is.
That's what? 21? No, how long is it?
About 20 years.
20 years, going on 21. Oh, my goodness. Mm-hmm. So, where were you born? Were you from here?
I was born in New Orleans, Louisiana, and went to college there in New Orleans. And then I went to medical school in New Orleans, LSU.
Yeah.
Then I went to Virginia for an internship and a residency in cancer treatment. And then in 1976, I came to Fort Wayne and now the head of the radiation oncology department at several of the hospitals here.
So are you a director or of?
Yeah, but all the doctors are equal. We just sort of have a director.
Yeah. So how long, what made you want to go through to be a doctor? Who was your mentor?
My probably primary motivation in picking any field that I was going to go into, I wanted something that would be different every day.
Yeah.
Routine is, I don't like routine.
Not 9 to 5.
And something meaningful also, and a physician fit the bill very nicely.
John?
Well, it's interesting that you've chosen medicine, because medicine, I believe, is at the top of the sciences today, not only locally, but in the United States. There's so much interesting material happening, and particularly in oncology.
Right. Yes. When I came to Fort Wayne, we cured about 1 out of 3 cancer patients. Now we cure about 55%. So in that period of time, every year we get 1 or 2% better. Mm. There are still some cancers that are very hard to treat, like pancreas cancer, lung cancer, and there are others where if you find them early, we cure 90%. But when you average it all out, everybody walks in the door, we cure about 55%. And even those we don't cure, we often can improve their life for a long time.
Yeah.
And the treatments these days are much less toxic than they used to be.
Chemotherapy, radiation.
Yeah, we've been able to refine them a lot better.
Do you have infusions?
Sure.
Like, that'd be chemo, right?
That's chemotherapy. Mm. Mm-hmm.
Thinking about my own father-in-law, my own father-in-law lasted 10 full years after he was first diagnosed with cancer of the throat.
Oh.
And never had an operation, but was very, very successful and very happy in his life until probably the last 10 days of it.
Very good.
So that's important. That's what medicine has done in the last 10 to 20 years.
Correct.
So, how old were you when you moved to Fort Wayne?
27.
27.
I was board certified in my field at 27. I skipped a few years of school.
Oh, yeah.
Got here a few years earlier than most people would.
How long did it take for you to learn to be taught to be a physician?
Well, it depends where you start counting. If you start counting at medical school, then you're going to count those years plus the residency and the training and the internship, then it's about 10 years.
Oh.
If you count college, then it's even more. Just depends where you start counting.
That's an awful lot of learning, and I'm happy that you're here to help people who have cancer.
Right, and even now, our group, we allow plenty of time for continued learning. So about 1 week out of 10, we're usually off at school learning new stuff.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Which school do you go to?
When I say school, I mean like meetings usually. Seminars, meetings of national groups.
You always got to keep up with the times.
Right. Yes.
So in 1993, Police Academy, Fort Wayne, Citizen Police Academy.
When I was thinking about running for city council, I wanted to learn some more things about the city.
And what did you learn?
Just some of the police procedures, how they do things, how they investigate things, just general things, nothing particular.
Nothing particular? Well, there was a special year in 1994.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody got married.
Okay.
High five.
Okay.
Bob and I got married in 1991, so we beat you by about 3 years.
Okay.
In 1995, you were active in other organizations. Mm-hmm. Like what?
Oh, I've been on the boards of the different cancer societies, some different community things. Quest Foundation used to be Fort Wayne Education Foundation that gets scholarships for students to go through college. And so lots of things.
As a council at large, what are your duties?
All city council basically serve two primary functions. We are the legislative branch of the Fort Wayne government. We pass all the laws, okay, subject to signing by the mayor and either vetoing or overriding his veto. And we also do budgetary oversight. So in other words, when the budget comes down from the mayor, he might propose.
Mm-hmm.
And then at that point, we can pass the budget or we can cut any line of the budget.
There has to be the right language in that bill, right?
Well, the right language is nice, but the right numbers are even better.
Yeah.
So in other words, it depends a lot on how much revenue we have and governing is nothing but choices.
Yeah.
In other words, there's never enough money for everything you want, so you have to prioritize. Mm. And
right.
So governing is choices.
Yeah. So Fort Wayne is starting to change for the better, I do hope.
I think so. I don't know how long you've been in town, but
about 8 years.
All right. Well, if you had looked at the downtown 20 years ago when I first came on council and then came back and looked at it today, you'd be quite amazed how much change and how much improvement there has been. So,
I can attest to the fact that there's been a lot of change.
Right.
And I've lived through most of it.
Mm-hmm.
Been around 70 years or so.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was a little boy, there were streetcars in Fort Wayne.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of things have changed. When I was preparing for this interview, I thought I would mention the three things that I've noticed the most.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them has to do with the use of tobacco in the city, something that I'm really, really happy has happened, and good for the health of people and also good for the way the city looks.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, also related to health, but we had a horrible pigeon problem for a number of years.
Mm-hmm.
Where they were uncontrolled in the downtown area, and we don't have those anymore. And then I think a lot of the blight downtown is slowly but surely being replaced by what I would regard as exciting building projects. and renewal projects.
All right. Well, those are very good observations, and I've been involved in some of those things. Like there had been two attempts to pass a secondhand smoking ordinance in Fort Wayne before I got on the council. And at that point, we began a monumental fight about having a smoking ordinance in Fort Wayne. Because one thing you will learn about Fort Wayne if you're involved in the politics, Fort Wayne, Indiana, does not like anything new, okay? If it's a new smoking ordinance, they're against it. If it's a new baseball stadium, they're against it. Now,
people don't like change.
They particularly around here, okay? So when we passed the smoking ordinance, that was like World War III. We had 300 people come to our public hearing, about half for it, half against it. The vote came down to, we had one for the workplaces, which passed fairly easily, and the mayor signed it. The one for the restaurants passed 5-4. The mayor vetoed it. Then we brought back and overrode his veto with a 7-2 vote.
How long ago was this, dear? How long ago was this?
That first one was 1996.
Okay. And who was the mayor?
Paul Helmke at that time. And once again, it's a tricky issue. In other words, I'm kind of a fiscal conservative, but to be honest with you, more of a libertarian about everything else. In other words, I think governments should stay out of your pocketbook, fiscal conservatism, and stay out of everything else unless your actions are hurting someone else or their property.
Or themselves.
Now, the only thing with the smoking ordinance, it's a tricky one. Because I hate to tell a business owner you can do this or you can do that in your business. But on the other hand, secondhand smoke hurts another person. So therefore, it crosses the line that government should get involved, in my opinion. Now, in 96, when we passed it, that was the strongest one in the Midwest. But at that point, the data was still coming in on secondhand smoke. And as more came in, by 2007, it was apparent that even a short-term exposure to secondhand smoke, in other words, if you're in a room with secondhand smoke for 30 minutes, it will increase the clotting of your blood. In other words, the platelets will clump. So if you happen to have some already narrowing of your coronary artery, and that happens, you can actually have a heart attack just from that. So, and then also it became apparent that some of the things, when we originally passed the smoking ordinance, we said, okay, you can have smoking in your restaurant, but only if you have a totally separate room enclosed in windows and doors.
So that's keeping all that, the
yeah,
stuff
but
in.
That wasn't good enough. No. By 2007, there's always leakage into the other rooms, and you still weren't addressing the employees and some of the other people that had to be around it. So in 2007, we brought the smoking ordinance back and made it a total ban in restaurants, public, anything public. Even like a private club. In other words, if you had an employee at a private club, then no smoking. Everything pretty much except homes.
That's how I got my COPD. My sister smoked.
Yeah. And once again, years ago, that wasn't as well known as it is now. So in 2007, we passed the strongest ordinance in Indiana and one of the strongest in the Midwest. And once again, it was just as big a fight to make it stronger in 2007 as it was in 1996.
Yeah.
And one thing you learn about
it's a habit,
when you're on council, anytime you do anything, like the fight, for example, the new baseball stadium, 65% of people were very much against that when I voted for it. Now 85% of people like it. But every time you do something on council, my favorite expression about politics is friends come and go and enemies accumulate. So as you go along, anytime you do something, you're adding to your club of enemies. So, but I mean, the easiest way to get reelected is to do nothing. But what's the point of being there? So I've always been one that kind of gets into the controversial things, and I really don't care if I get reelected or not.
But you're there to help people, not to hinder
them. I'm there
them.
To make the city a better place, yes.
Which leads up to the homeless.
Yes, very good topic. There's the homeless problem is a complex problem.
Very much.
Now, do you know the difference between a complicated problem and a complex problem?
Complicated is when you can't do much for it.
Wrong. Complicated is it has lots of details that must be worked out.
Oh.
For example, let's suppose the three of us wanted to design a jet engine.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we would have many things to learn, many things to test, and we would have to test it and test it and test it. But once we got it right, we got it. We can make 100,000 more jet engines just exactly like it and never have a problem. That's a complicated problem. A complex problem has so many moving variables that you can never really control them all. For example, you might want to predict who's going to win the football game. Okay, you can look at the statistics and who played who and all that. And you might have some odds, but on any particular day, you're never going to know who's going to win that football game. And homeless are like that, and cancer is somewhat like that. There's so many variables and so many things that can change. We will never solve the homeless problem. But we may be able to improve it and manage it much better than we are now.
Well, there's someone down in Utah who helped the homeless for the whole state.
There are different ways. When you say help, what do you mean?
Well, got them homes.
That's one thing, but did that really help them?
And then they got them jobs.
Okay. Now, do you know what the DOE project is in New York City? Okay. This started out, there was a man who really wanted to help the homeless, and he would go to the train station and give them sandwiches.
Yeah.
Okay, but then he realized that was only really helping a little bit. Even though they had a place to sleep and a sandwich, their life was terrible.
Yeah.
Then one lady was found outside, frozen to death, and she was a Jane Doe. So at that point, he says, "I got to do more." So then that began the Doe Project. So he found an abandoned school in Harlem, I believe, and basically set it up that he was going to set up a program that if you wanted to change your life, you had to convince his people that you really wanted to change. That's your first thing. To get in, you had to say, "I'm willing to work and do the hard things to change." Now, once you got in, the first thing they did is, you got to be off drugs, got to be off alcohol, we'll give you a place to sleep, we'll feed you, but now you got to work. And how you started out was cleaning the streets. They gave them a bucket and a mop and a uniform, and they went out and cleaned the streets. And they began to develop a sense of value, a sense of accomplishment. They got a little paycheck for doing that.
I think that's
They got a little savings account.
Yeah.
And after 3 months, they said, "I'm feeling better about myself. I want to do more." So now they're more interested in getting a skill, like maybe a pest control technician or something like that. They go back to school. They get a better job. And now they're interested in taking care of their family, getting reintegrated into society. And that program's had 22,000 people that have graduated from it.
Oh.
And 3/4 of them didn't go back to crime, didn't go back to addictions, and are now taxpaying assets of the community rather than liabilities.
How can we get that here?
We have it here.
We do.
If you look at the rescue mission, okay, their program is threefold. Number one, if you come into their programs, like you have to say, "I want to change," then the first thing they do is try to correct whatever pathology got you to be homeless in the first place.
Yeah.
If you're alcohol, drug dependent, mental health problems, whatever, you got to fix those first. Once you fix those, then you try to teach them some new skills, computer skills, English, writing, whatever they need to make them employable. Then you try to get them a job. Okay.
Right.
Now, once again, the whole thing about this is you have to look at the homeless instead of a permanent liability as a potential asset. If you can give them a sense of value to themselves and their family and the community, then you suddenly have a tax-paying citizen. But to do that, that's a lot of work.
And you need counselors, too.
You need all that stuff.
Everything.
And you
doctors.
Need lots of resources. And the rescue mission needs at least double their capacity that they have right now.
So
if you want to solve, you're never going to solve, but if you want to improve the homeless problem, you've got to look at some comprehensive approach like that. You don't want to just throw them a hamburger under the bridge. You don't want to even give them a house, because if you just give them a house, well, how are they going
to
support
themselves?
You
have to work on them.
You have to, values is the important part. Meaningful work is a big part of it.
Yeah.
But that's hard work. And now tonight,
but I think it's worth it.
Tonight, we're going to talk about the simplest of all problems with homeless, about when to open a warming station.
Yes.
Okay? And right now, because of resources and various other things, the warming station that the city runs opens at 10 degrees. Okay? Ambient temperature or 0 degrees wind chill. Mm. And sometimes depends a little bit whether there's snow and rain. Now, several homeless advocates have been coming to us over the last year or so and said, look, we think that's too low. So I researched all the medical data on it, and it is too low. People can have potentially life-threatening hyperthermia at 32 degrees. And these people have comorbidities. If you're on alcohol, your blood vessels are dilated. You lose you lose heat quicker.
Yeah.
So these people are very vulnerable to freezing to death. So 32 degrees is too high.
Yes.
I mean, 10 degrees is too low. So I'm going to a resolution to change it to 32 degrees. Okay. Yeah. And that's just a resolution. It's a recommendation. And so we'll see if council passes that tonight. And if they do, then the administration will have to decide, do we have the resources? Do we have the ability to organize that? Right now, the rescue mission is the primary warming station and shelter. They open at 40 degrees for a certain period of time. 32 degrees, they have a little more space. But this is just people like sleeping in the halls. Mm-hmm. But there are some people that can't get into the rescue mission because they have rules about whether you're on alcohol or drugs or if you've been there so many days. There's some people that don't want to go there.
Yeah.
So my point and my resolution is, if we think it's the right thing to do to have a warming station at 10 degrees, and there are some people that might need that, then you have to do it right. Mm-hmm. And if they need it at 10, they need it at 11 and 12 and 13 and 14 and 15, all the way up to 32 at least.
At least.
The governor of New York on January the 3rd just passed an executive order mandating all local governments in the state to take the homeless off the streets at 32 degrees, even by force if necessary, because he states that's just basic humanity. So I think if we're going to do it in Fort Wayne, we need to do it right.
Yeah.
So 10 degrees is simply too low.
It is too low. And what about it opens from 8 to 8?
That is correct.
Well, at night, when it really is cold.
At night, then they need to go either they go to the rescue mission and then or Salvation Army is the backup. And once again, we need more space in both. And they don't have the resources necessarily. And that's why another reason for the 10 degrees, that's partly because some of the other agencies said we just don't have the resources to do it.
Yeah.
But once again, if you're going to do it, you got to do it right.
Oh, you got to do it. Really good job. I just know it. So there's a meeting, you said, tonight?
Every Tuesday night.
Every Tuesday night.
5:30 p.m.
5:30.
At least four times a month. The first four Tuesdays. The fifth Tuesday, if there's five Tuesdays in a month, we don't meet. But always four times a month.
How long is it, an hour or 2 hours?
As long as a man's legs are, as long as it takes.
I like this guy. Do you have anything?
Well, I have all kinds of things.
We don't have too much time. We got about 5 minutes.
The next topic is river development.
Ah.
And I think that's a very, very interesting project. I've seen that done in other communities and seen it as a successful operation. What are your opinions on riverfront development?
One of the reasons I wanted to run for council again another term is I wanted to be part of that. In other words, I think riverfront development is the next big thing in Fort Wayne. The community actually seems in favor of this new thing.
Okay.
It's going to be a lot of money, a lot of decisions, and I think having gone through the thing with the baseball stadium when I was on council, that was a good thing. I'm glad I voted for that. You always learn how to do the big deal a little bit better the next time. So I think some of that experience will be helpful.
Well, you know, we only have about 3 minutes left.
All right. I can tell you something I'd like to talk about. The next 4 years are going to be fascinating. We have riverfront development is going to be a huge issue. There are going to be potential annexations on areas around the periphery of the city. We possibly could have a downtown arena brought to the council for a decision. There's a group studying that now. That'll be a lot of money, a lot of decisions as to whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. potential tax increases based on just the regular budget. We just won the regional cities competition where there'll be a regional development authority.
Right.
But if you want to get some of that money, you have to match it. So you, like for example, if you have a $10 million project, you have to come up with $6 million of private funds and $2 million of local funds. So how that money is obtained, we might have to consider a tax increase or use legacy funds or lots of things. So there are going to be a lot of new decisions.
Mm-hmm.
We have 4 new council people out of 9. That is a historic number of new ones in one time. And the last thing a new council person wants to do is annex, which is unpopular, pass a tax increase, which is unpopular, and vote for a downtown arena, which will be unpopular with the citizens of Fort Wayne because it's new.
And it's also 200 years old this year,
yes, right.
Fort Wayne.
So we will have a wild and woolly year this year. So if you want to watch council, it'll be an interesting year because I have no idea how this council will decide many of these things.
Oh, this will be interesting. It'll be interesting. And I know you, with you on it, you're going to do a really good job.
Well, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. John Crawford and John Dickmeyer.
Are you finished?
I think so.
No, you're not finished.
I'm not?
We can talk more about riverfront development.
Oh, okay. I don't know. We got less than 2.
Yeah, we can talk a little bit
okay.
more.
Okay, I thought we were saying goodbye.
We got a minute.
Okay, fine.
Oh, look, I have to go.
Well, the riverfront development, the first thing is we're going to construct something called a promenade, okay, which is basically a big kind of outdoor deck, and that's where people will gather at the riverfront. The city, the government must do that. That's going to be government money. We mm-hmm. have to acquire property. We have to build it. And at that point, we hope if we build it, they will come. We're hoping at that point the private development will start to spring up around it. And that's the whole idea of this.
Well, thank you, John Dickmeyer, for coming
thank
on
you.
To my show, being
thank
a co-host.
You,
and
yeah,
you,
thank you then.
John Crawford.
Yes.
Doctor. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you for coming on to my show. And we'll see you next week. And God bless. Bye-bye.
Godspeed, my love, until we meet again. You're always in my heart and every dream. Don't let this time apart give in to all our fears. God will keep us close from up above. So until we meet again, Godspeed.